And now hear the word of the Lord, calling us to wait on the Lord. I'd like to read a passage from the 27th Psalm, the first and last verses of that psalm, and then a passage from the 40th chapter of Isaiah, the 31st verse, and then a personal word from our Lord as to what to do in the waiting times. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the light of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. But those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. And Jesus said, the 11th chapter of Matthew, 29th and 28th and 30th verses, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly of heart, and you will find rest for your soul. Let us pray. O gracious Lord, help us to know how to wait on you. In Christ's name, amen. It's a word we all hate to hear. It's more frustrating than the word no, that gives a death blow to our dreams. It's more challenging than yes, that gives us a go-ahead to some plan that we'd like to carry out, that stretches every sinew of our being. It's the abhorred word of youth, the rejected word of the visionary. It's the hated word of those who are ill, or those who love those who are ill. It's a word that we'd like very much to extricate from the lexicon of our lives once and for all. I'm talking about the word wait. It's a word that haunts us all of our lives. When we're kids, we're told to wait until we grow up. When we get to be teenagers, they say, wait until you get to college. You get to college, and they say, wait until you get out of college. And you get out of college, and they say, wait until you get married. And when you get married, they say, wait until you get kids. And when you get kids, you say, wait until they leave home. We wait for retirement. We wait for ease. We wait for death. Wait, 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 wait. You know, airports and train stations simply do not have an exclusive on waiting rooms. All of life is kind of an anteroom of waiting for that expected fulfillment, for that satisfaction that we long for so much. I get tired of the trite old saying, all things come to those who wait. Maybe a part of my being likes Thomas Edison's rendering of that a lot better. Everything comes for those who wait and hustle while they wait. It is very hard to just passively sit and wait. Sarah Doudney put it very, very clearly. She said, there are times of silent sorrow in the seasons of our lives. There are wild and desperate moments. There are hours of mental strife. There are times when we feel the silent anguish, when tears refuse to fall. But the waiting times, my friends, are the hardest times of all. We turn to the Bible, thinking that we're going to get an answer there. And all we find across the pages of the Psalms and the prophets and even the message of Jesus right on into the apostles is, wait on the Lord. And that conjures up kind of a strange image in our minds. It's of God, who's a tired out old deity. We have to wait for him to catch up with us as we race on in our own plans and purposes. Not what it means at all. When the psalmist tells us that the answer given to him in the midst of his lament and his anguish was to wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and the Lord would strengthen his heart, and just to be sure he heard, he repeated it, wait, I say, on the Lord. We are given an understanding of what it means to wait that is much more than simply passivity and doing nothing. As a matter of fact, it's like an active verb. It involves us in a dynamic experience. Waiting is a part of life simply because God in his wisdom has divided life into the past, the present, and the future. There's always a tomorrow. We always long to know what's coming. What should we do? What should we say? And let me tell you, friends, when you stop waiting, you stop living. When you're not excited about tomorrow, it's time to die. What a wonderful thing it is that in waiting, God explains some of the complexities that badger our minds and distress our spirits. Waiting on God is the time when he reveals to us what we cannot understand on our own. Life does have those unanswered questions, those complexities. And it's only as we wait on him that we are able to hear his answers. Oh, so often we falsely say, you know, I've just been running ahead of God. What arrogance. How can you run ahead of God? Can you get ahead of light? Can you move faster than the movement of light? Of course not. As a matter of fact, God in his grace slowed light down enough so that we could see what light was all about in the Savior. And he said, I am the light of the world. So waiting on God is not to cajole him into coming to us. It's rather to condition ourselves to receive the one who is already present. So, how do you get the best out of the waiting times? Know what you're to expect. And I can promise you with everything in my being that there are three things you can expect and three things that you will receive when you wait on him. And the first is the gift of himself, the gift of the presence of God. The other morning I woke up. I don't know if this ever happens to you, but it did to me. I started my devotions. My mind was racing. Everything in my being wanted to get through that day with gusto. I began my devotions, moving through adoration, confession, thanksgiving, intercession, supplication, the review of the needs of the day, dedication, and I raced through it so fast that I didn't even think about it. It was rote, plip, plip. God, you heard, I'm on my way. And I wondered why that was one of the most difficult days that I've had in a long time. It was because in my time with him, I didn't wait in each step of prayer to recognize that I'd been called to prayer by God, to tell him how much I love him, and then take time to glorify him, to allow him to tell me what I need to confess, and then to confess it boldly and experience his forgiveness, to be able to thank him for his goodness, and then to spread out before him my own and the needs of others, knowing that he has a plan and a purpose, and then to trust him completely. You see, I didn't need to get slowed down to his pace. Really, what I thought was a racing mind was a kind of a tired mind. And it needed to rest in the Lord so that it could get speeded up to his pace and his timing and his plan and his purpose. And that's what happens when you take time to wait on the Lord. Remember now, let me put an underline under it. Waiting is to condition ourselves to receive what God has to give, not to cajole him to give. He's more ready than we are if we'll wait on him. But secondly, waiting on God gives us one gift we need more than anything else. And I caution you, don't ever pray for this gift. The gift we need is patience. Praying for the gift of patience is sure to be followed with opportunities to learn patience. But if you seek God and his presence and power as you wait on him, then, inadvertently, as a result, the gift of patience is given. And it comes first as an intellectual discovery. We see the length of time and the shortness of our existence. We see the length of eternity and the shortness of the moments of our lives. And we begin to feel the intensity of God's plan and purpose for us. And having received him, we say, anything else or anyone else is secondary to having received him. That's the source of patience. You can't be a patient person unless you're satisfied with God for God. Once you are, then you can be patient with people, patient with his deliberate movement in evolving the answers to your prayers, patient with the future, forgiving of the past. You get into a rhythm when he's more important than anything he can give. But dear friends, when you wait on the Lord, you not only receive patience, but creative impatience. God gives us a divine discontent. He makes us unhappy with those things that contradict him and his justice, his righteousness. He gets us moving according to his plan rather than our own. And it all comes when we wait on him. But lastly, waiting on the Lord gives us power. It's there in that 27th Psalm. Be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Isaiah knew that. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up like with wings like eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They'll walk and not faint. William Ernest Hawking, in his famous classic book on experiencing the power of God, talked about the divine theory of alternation. He said, if there are not deliberate pauses, we eventually get in our own way and ruin our own work. We outrage ourselves if we don't take time to wait for God. When the disciples were raring to go, Jesus said, cool your heels. Go to the upper room and wait a while. And when they waited, they got ready. And when they were ready, the power of the Holy Spirit was sent into them so that they could be sent out into the church. What a tragedy it would have been if those disciples would have tried to change the world without Pentecost. And I believe that each waiting time, every day, is a little Pentecost in which Jesus Christ gives us the power to do what it is that he's guided us to do. And what a difference it makes. You see, God will not give his strength for anything other than what he has guided. And we have to wait for him to tell us what to ask for so he can give us the strength for that which he wants us to do. Sarah Doudney concludes her poem in a wonderful way. For then we will have learned the lesson that God knows what is best. For with wisdom comes patience, and with patience comes rest. And oh, the golden thread is shining through the jangled woof of what we call fate. And our hearts shall thank him meekly that he has taught us how to wait.